Well, it's been 6 months since the government's inquiry into mental health and addiction reported back, and as yet, still no response from the government. Jacinda Ardern indicated it would come before the budget, which is now just over a week away. So what can we expect and when can we expect it? Joining us from Wellington to provide an answer, amongst other things, is Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern. Good morning.
Good morning.
So, as I just said in the introduction, we're waiting for a response on this mental health inquiry. At the post-CAB conference, you said it's going to come before the budget. So when can we expect it?
Before the budget. One of the things, though, that we've made really clear is, of course, that the response from the government, that's really just, you know, the line-by-line response to each of the recommendations. And so that's what we need to do to round out that process. But actually, this has been the case all the way through. The biggest difference that we'll be able to make is the way that we deliver services and the kind of services we deliver. And for that, we need the budget. And so really, regardless of when the formal response to all the recommendations come out, it will be the budget that people are waiting for and looking to. We actually made mental health a priority for this budget. And so I know people will be looking to see what the next steps will be when that comes out next week.
I absolutely understand that. But in something so important.
I also should point out that doesn't mean we have done nothing in the space of mental health. Yes, we wanted to dig in a little bit more into what those who are currently using services could tell us around what was missing, where we needed extra investment. But at the same time, we already identified that we had, for instance, an issue with the mental health and wellbeing, for instance, of kids who have been through the earthquakes in Kaikoura and Canterbury. So we put in place Mana Ake, a program which means there's mental health and support in every primary school in the Canterbury region. So we've already rolled that out. That's in every school now. And thankfully that's been there because the consequence of 15th of March means that that need's been there. We've also started rolling out mental health support in high schools. So we've been increasing the deciles that we're moving through. So work has been going on all the while as well.
Do you think the people who shared their stories with the inquiry will be happy with the announcement that you make?
I think that ultimately I need to let them make their judgment on that. What I can at least say is that a huge amount of thought has gone into the response. You know, one of the issues, though, was that whilst there were a number of recommendations, actually when it comes to service delivery and specific programs, there was actually a little bit more work that was left to be done after the inquiry. But I hope so. You know, I hope they see that the efforts there are genuine, that we finally need to take mental health seriously, and that we are.
Now, you are also tackling the culture of bullying within Parliament. The Debbie Francis report is meant to be out today. Now, yesterday you said that, yes, the culture in Parliament needs to change. What has your experience been, just for people who don't understand what it's like?
Yeah, well, the Speaker actually was the one, and I need to give credit to him for this piece of work, decided that He wanted someone independently to look at the workplace and culture in here. And I should acknowledge that this is primarily a focus really on staff members. But I'm sure that there'll be some discussion around issues between MPs as well. But I do think that this is a place where no matter who you are when you're working in here, it is a pretty tough environment, and that is particularly tough for the people who work here. There are long hours. There's a power issue there. Of course, they're working for people who are elected, but none of that is an excuse. Every workplace, you should be a place where you're treated with dignity and respect.
And your government's about wellbeing, as stated about your upcoming budget. I just want to talk about the $320 million that is set aside for the family and sexual violence. Now, this was a joint bid from 8 ministries.
Yeah.
Who's going to divvy up that money?
Well, again, the work now, actually, that we're doing as a government is joint work now. And that's been one of the issues that previously, when we've dealt with an issue like domestic violence, we've left it up to different departments to make their own bids and essentially do their own thing. And what that means for someone who's a victim of family violence is that that's being reflected in the way they've access services. It's been disjointed. We haven't thought about a coordinated plan. So now we have something called the joint venture. Everyone is working together. For instance, a survivor should have a much more seamless experience now when they're accessing support. So they shouldn't have to worry about the fact that there are, you know, different ministries involved, and that's the whole goal.
Do you think the joint bid process and the way that you're going to run government is going to increase or decrease bureaucracy?
Well, certainly, I mean, our focus is, you know, making sure we do what works, but also making sure that people don't have that experience of everything feeling disjointed on the ground. And ultimately, that should reduce bureaucracy, but we're really focusing on the experience of those people who are accessing services, and that's as it should be. No one thinks about issues in terms of government departments and who's responsible for what, so we've got to stop thinking that way.
Brett O'Reilly from the Employers and Manufacturers Association has made a comment that business are upset about the cost of compliance, and they want to know, is the government going to start measuring the cost of compliance with all this new legislation that you've put up?
Yeah, and I saw that piece, and reference in that piece was made to things like the minimum wage, for instance. And yes, we as a government have increased the minimum wage. We've signalled, we've signposted now where it's going to go right out to 2021 as well. But the reason we've done that is we, of course, need to make sure that people are earning enough to survive. And at the same time, one of the big issues we've had coming in from business is actually the ability to find staff. And so, you know, wages, decent wages help with that, as do us making sure that training and education is accessible, and we're working on that too. But we've also done other things to try and make it a bit easier on business. We've been working on e-invoicing to cut down those costs. ACC levies have reduced, so they're going to save about $100 million for business. So we are mindful of those costs, but at the same time, we have to also think about some of the pressures there, like people having decent wages.
There's so many pressures on people today. We had, just before the news, we had people asking for more funding for cochlear implants.
Cochlear implants, yeah.
They got the St John's Ambulance, would like to be fully funded. Obviously, the teacher strike is coming up. How is the government going to deal with all of this, their call for your money, for our money?
And look, this is the challenge of government. But actually, those three issues, they really demonstrate a good point. So for the teachers, you know, roughly on average about $10,000 for a teacher over 2 years, a $1.2 billion package. We know that there's a lot of need in education, but we do also have those competing interests. And so that's a really good illustration of that point. We can't do everything at once in education because it means we aren't able to do things in those other areas like mental health, like domestic violence. Cochlear implants, they've roughly had about 8.3 million from memory has been going into cochlear implants, with the exception of 1 year where they got an additional one off. I know the minister is having a little look at digging into those numbers a bit more and seeing if there's any more that can be done in that space. And look, St John's, it's a quirk of our system. They've never been fully funded, which will seem odd to most New Zealanders, but it's a historical quirk. We know we need to move them to sustainable funding. We'll have a little bit more to say on that this morning.
Thank you very much. That's Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern. Welcome home.
Thank you. Thank you.